video was originally recorded May 2018 at Tibet House, US in New York City. To watch more videos from this program, please visit tibethouse.us.
I requested that we start with a little bit of meditation. So we'll do a little bit of Menla meditation, even though we're in New York and Tibet House. But we'll do a little Tibetan style one. Okay? And you have a lot of tanka still on the wall. So that's kind of nice, you know. But you may have your own icon image. Okay, so go into meditative mode. And take a few deep breaths. Not too deep. But take a couple of breaths. And relax. And then imagine that you're looking into your own face. You're following the famous Mark Epstein mindfulness meditative metaphor of setting your mindfulness up in front of yourself and looking back into your own face and looking to see the real you, to find the real you. And not being sure really if it is the tip of your nose or the middle of your brain or your heart, certainly it's not the mask of your face. And if you feel a little disoriented trying to do that, looking back into your body and self, body, mind, and self, then just be disoriented and let yourself melt a little bit into maybe acknowledging your uncertainty about who you really are. And then imagine that your melted state, the lump of whatever you are, is in your ideal environment. Top of a mountain, and a wonderful, safe, secluded clearing in a beautiful forest, sitting by a stream. I always like to be sitting on a grassy slope going down to Lake Manasarovar with Mount Kailash behind me in the north and all kind of snow-peaked mountains in a circle beyond the lake and some fluffy clouds in a blue sky. And then imagine that in the sky, whoever is your most cherished mentor, if you have a teacher, if you're a Zenni, a Roshi, if you're a Tibetan type, a Lama, if you're a Vipassana person, maybe a Burmese master, or Thai, or Vietnamese, and whoever is, or some ancient person, Buddha, or somebody in another religion, Krishna, or Jesus, or Moses, or Muhammad, whoever it might be, that the most amazing being that you'd feel most amazed about if they were here with you right now, in the sky, looking down at you, smiling at you, blessing you, with sort of light cascading down from that person, or persons, if there's a number of such beings in your history or in your imagination. So that you feel like you would feel if this most esteemed person or persons was actually present. And then arise in that context with open self-definition, discarding any self-evaluations like I can't meditate, I can't visualize, I'm this, I'm that, whatever, we're thinking about something else. And just temporarily feel you're in the ideal refuge situation with your mind totally open to what you might come to understand, with what you might come to feel, with how positive you might imagine the world around you. Just bathe in such a setting. And if you can, you can also add to it a feeling of all beings being around you and whatever gracious feeling you may have by imagining this protector beings above you. You want to share with all the beings around you, like a metta thing. May you feel protected, and may you feel grace, and may you feel blessed, and may you feel buoyed up by positive setting. So, in other words, you imaginatively create a setting of refuge and a setting of sharing refuge. So you're both receiving and giving. In the Tibetan tradition, at the beginning of a meditation or a session of learning, creating the most positive setting your imagination is capable of is considered essential to a successful session of meditation. Once you feel in such a positive setting, then you can forget about the setting and turn your mind to counting your breath 1 to 10, like a mindfulness thing, or whatever it is you may be working on in your own practice, within a kind of super positive setting, like which you do create habitually in a meditation room or space or shrine. So you make this shrine around you before you start, and then you forget about it and focus on whatever you want to focus, whatever you're working on. In my own case, I like to meditate on the preciousness of the human embodiment, endowed with intelligence and opportunity, and with compassion and friends and companions and loved ones and loving ones, and how such a wonderful evolutionary opportunity. I should try to waste my time less than I do. That's what I tend to focus on. Trying to appreciate more the positive situation so as to waste it less. Okay. Dr. Sharon.
My name's Dr. Mark.
Dr. Mark.
So you all know our topic for today? From anxiety, addiction, and depression to love, relief, and understanding.
Oh my God. How lucky.
I'm assuming most of us are in the former camp, but maybe a little bit reaching towards the love, relief, and understanding. Many of you probably know my work. If you don't, I'm a psychiatrist, psychotherapist. Can you hear me all right in the back? I had the fortunate circumstance to be exposed to Buddhism, to learn about Buddhism, to begin to meditate when I was in my early 20s, before I knew very much about anything else, certainly before I knew very much about Western psychology or what it would mean to be a therapist or psychoanalysis or psychodynamics or anything. So I had a glimpse when I was quite young, it now seems. It didn't seem so then. But I had a glimpse of something beyond what I was familiar with that came right away with the Dharma that has continued to inspire me throughout all the years that have intervened since. And becoming a psychiatrist and working as a therapist, and a lot of my personal work and my work as a therapist and my writing work has been trying to make sense of what I glimpsed early on from the Dharma and trying to integrate that with then the learning that came from working with real people and their depression and anxiety and addiction, and also working with my own versions of those things. So you can look at it as what does Buddhism have to teach psychotherapy, or even lately I've been reversing it some and trying to talk or think about what the world of psychotherapy has to teach Buddhism, because I think it's a mistake to imagine that either of them can do it all. And for those of us in personalities and with childhoods and conditioned by 100 years of psychoanalysis, we think about ourselves as formed by our early life and need some help with that also. But I want to try to talk first for tonight and for tomorrow about that sense of specialness that I glimpsed from Buddhism early on. And the best way, I've sort of collaged a few things together that I want to present to you. And the first came to me a few years ago when I was for 3 days visiting in Santiago, Chile, and talking about the kind of stuff that we always talk about together, the role of mindfulness and how mindfulness sets up what we call in psychotherapy a holding environment in which we don't have to be afraid of the worst aspects of ourselves, where we can learn to hold them with mindfulness, with attention, etc. And how that opens up and some glimpse, as I was saying already, of some other capacity that's latent in us. And one of the people at this workshop in Santiago brought out a poem of Pablo Neruda's that he translated for me into English that he thought what I was saying evoked for him. And I don't know why he thought that what I was saying evoked the poem, but the poem evokes a lot for me. So I'm going to read it to you. It's just called Poetry. So I'm equating poetry with the Dharma in this poem, reading this poem. And it was at that age, Neruda says, poetry came to get me. I'm not sure, not sure where it came from winter or river, not sure how or when. No, they were not voices, they were not words nor silence, but from a street it called me, from night's branches, suddenly among the others, amid violent fires or coming back alone. There it was, faceless, and it touched me. I did not know what to say, my mouth did not know how to name, my eyes were blind, and something beat inside my soul. Fever or lost wings, and I went on making my way, solving that burn, and I wrote the first vague line, vague without substance, pure nonsense, pure wisdom of someone who knows nothing, and I suddenly saw heaven scattered and open, planets, throbbing fields, the shadow, wounded, riddled by arrows, fire and flowers, the overwhelming night, the universe, and I, minimal being, drunk from the great starry void, akin, resembling the mystery, felt a pure part of the abyss. I rolled with the stars, my heart unraveled in the wind. Mm. So that's how I felt when I first found the Dharma. But I couldn't have said it like that. But I think there's something about poetry, there's something about being able to put words on nameless experience, something about opening to some kind of mysterious aspect of our being that Buddhism leads with, that speaks to our sense of confusion. The confusion that comes with having an ego and being born a baby and having to make sense of the world from the age of two or three or whenever consciousness dawns, and how you have to get yourself together to cope with your internal and external environment, and this sense of spaciousness, of mystery, of one's heart unraveling with the wind and floating in the void, that gets submerged. But there's something in Buddhism that wants us to recontact that, that lets us recontact that. So in terms of what's special about Buddhism, I can see it two ways, and I think in a way, those of you who are familiar with Buddhist thought, there's the so-called Hinayana path or the Theravada path, where you basically see the mind as something that needs to be disciplined, that needs to be brought under control, that's thoughts without a thinker, that where your thoughts are going on and on without you and your ego is leading you around by the nose kind of thing, but that it's possible to gain control by learning mindfulness, by learning to discipline, tame the mind. That's one way to look at it. And then maybe what we would call it, people will criticize me for this, but we could call it the Mahayana view, where one's heart, one's Buddha nature, one's enlightened self is already present within. We just don't see it or know it or feel it because of our level of ego confusion and our conditioned addiction and anxiety and depression. But if we can make the right kind of space, it can surprise us and suddenly emerge. So this is from a professor at the New School named Jeremy Safran, who did a book some years ago that was a dialogue between Buddhist teachers and psychotherapists. He was a back and forth between Buddhist teachers and psychotherapists talking about their approach to trying to save us from ourselves. He tragically died the other night, Jeremy Safran, but over the years I always quote the epigraph of this book, which I'll read to you in a minute. Is a very personal thing that he's writing about his relationship with his Tibetan Lama that I think is his attempt to talk about what I'm trying to talk about. So this is in a way in memory of him now. My Tibetan teacher, Karma Tinley Rinpoche, once asked me in his broken, heavily accented English, how does Western psychology treat nervousness? Why do you ask? I responded. Well, he replied, I've always been a nervous person. Even when I was a little boy, I was nervous, and I still am. Especially when I have to talk to large groups of people I don't know, I get nervous. As was often the case with the questions that Karma Tinley asked me, I found myself drawing a complete blank. Part of it was the difficulty of trying to find the words to explain something to somebody whose grasp of English was limited, but there was another more important factor. On the face of it, this was a simple question, but Karma Tinley was a highly respected lama, now in his 60s, who had spent years mastering the most sophisticated Tibetan Buddhist meditation techniques. Those who knew Karma Tinley considered him to be an enlightened being. In the West, psychotherapists are increasingly turning to Buddhist meditation as a valuable treatment for a variety of problems, including anxiety. Who was I to tell him how to deal with anxiety? And how was it possible that Karma Tinley, with all of his experience meditating, could still be troubled by such everyday concerns? How could an enlightened person be socially anxious? Was he really enlightened? What does it mean to be enlightened? My head swirled with all of these inchoate questions, and for a moment my mind stopped. I felt a sense of warmth coming from Karma Tinley, and I felt warmly towards him. I felt young, soft, open, and uncertain about everything I knew. So I called him up when I got the book, which he had asked me to blurb, and I called him up when I read this and told him how much I loved this, you know, this was my favorite thing in the book. And he said, oh, his editors wanted him to leave it out because they thought it would be too confusing to people. But I think that young, soft, open, and uncertain about everything he knew, that's the part that I love that more even than the socially anxious lama, although, you know, I don't think we have to think that our personalities change. We'll be talking about this as we go on. If should any of us ever reach enlightenment, I think we'll still be the same person that we always were. But Bob is the expert in that. He'll be telling us. Okay. From the psychoanalytic point of view, this is from a colleague and friend of mine named Michael Eigen, who's a psychoanalyst here in New York, now approaching, he's probably 80 years old or so. And he's an expert in a British psychoanalyst who's been a big influence on me named Wilfred Bion, from whose work I stole the phrase Thoughts Without a Thinker for my first book. Bion was born in India, came to London, trained as a psychoanalyst, and he had Samuel Beckett as his first patient. And he did a good job with him. They influenced each other, I think. So this is Eigen writing about Bion, but writing about, you'll see. I think Bion is trying to describe the worst in us, the worst in us. And I think he's trying to do something more. I feel he is saying we must and can survive the worst if we are to be truly compassionate with ourselves and each other, if we're going to be partners with the capacities that constitute us. One of the great experiences in reading Bion, I think, is that over and over we come through the worst. We survive ourselves, build up tolerance for ourselves, make room for ourselves. So I would say this applies to the Dharma also. That's why I'm reading this. That's what we're doing when we're practicing whatever we practice. If we're not using meditation to avoid ourselves, which is just as possible. Eigen goes on. In the face of the worst that he can experience or envision experiencing, including Beckett, and including total destruction of experience, Bion maintained a faith that openness to the unknowable ultimate reality of a session, of a moment, of a lifetime, is somehow linked with growth processes. I think that Bion must have been close to destroying every possibility of goodness in life and that he speaks from his own experience of surviving the great destruction. I think he must have discovered for himself that life erupts in the valley of the shadow of death. I think Bion always had an eye on the backcloth of destruction. He always was facing the horror of himself, a faith that, in spite of all horrors, experience is worthwhile, is different from use of faith to avoid experiencing. The faith Bion fought for was linked to intensity of living and risk of openness. So Sharon is the expert on faith, and we had lots of discussions about this, at this way of looking at faith as a willingness to be with oneself in all of one's most conflicted ways, with an eye towards that unknowable, ultimate, mysterious something that the Dharma is opening up for us and kind of magnetically pulling on us and giving us courage, really, I think, and the willingness to not waste time, as Bob's already talking about. One of the big influences on me early on was a former Harvard psychology professor who had already been kicked out of Harvard by the time I got to college, named Richard Alpert, who went on to go to India and rename himself Ramdas. And Bob, I believe, just came back from Maui, where he was spending time with him. But I knew him when I first found the Dharma. He was one of the people who introduced it to me. And then I spent a fair amount of time in relatively secret classes that he was giving in Cambridge in those years. And then didn't see him. I went to medical school, got married, moved to New York, had children. Didn't see him for a long time. He had a stroke, moved to California. And so about 20 years went by between visits. And then maybe 20 years ago, I went to see him after he'd had his stroke and had a short visit with him, an afternoon visit with him, when he was still living in California before he was in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. And he couldn't talk very well because the stroke took out he had a golden tongue before the stroke. But he had trouble, he could still think, but he had trouble getting the words. But we had a nice sort of elongated conversation that afternoon. And he was kind of teasing me by, are you a Buddhist psychiatrist now? You know, because he still saw me as being 20 years old, I think, even though I was probably 40. Are you a Buddhist psychiatrist now? And then he said, and I didn't understand him at first, he said, do you see them as already free? And he had to repeat it a couple times before I understood what he was saying. Do you see them, meaning my patients, do you see them as already free? And I thought, oh yeah, he nailed it. You know, like that's what I try to do. Because that's the great gift of working with people one-on-one, is I can kind of see who they would be if they weren't who they thought they were, which was Ram Dass's great line, you know, that you're not who you think you are. But I can feel that with most people, and so without being preachy about it, if I'm good at what I'm doing, I can kind of pull on that, on what I feel there, you know, is there already in them. I had a conversation with my own father in the weeks before he died, about 10 years ago now. My father was a scientist, what Bob would call a scientific materialist. Professor of medicine, first at Yale and then at Harvard, with whom I never talked about anything spiritual. When I was first starting out and he got a sense of what I was interested in, he was like, oh, there's a guy working for me. Maybe you could go get a summer job with him. He's kind of interested in this stuff. And it was Herbert Benson, who was a cardiologist who first studied transcendental meditation. So I worked with him for a while. But that was the most we ever talked, my father and I, about any of this. He was proud of my writing, and he had copies of my books in his office. But I never tried to convince him of anything or engage him really with it until he had a brain tumor, the same kind that John McCain has now and that Ted Kennedy died from. But it was on the non-dominant side of his brain, unlike where Ram Dass's stroke was on the dominant side, which is why it took out his speech. But this brain tumor was on the hidden side of my father's brain. So it only affected his sense of balance and direction. So he was still working and seeing patients and going to the hospital every day until he got lost one day driving home from the hospital, the same route he'd taken for 30 years. And that's when they found the tumor, and by then it was too late. It had already, you know, they couldn't do anything about it. And he, being a scientist, knew what was happening. And I, in my office one afternoon, realized, oh, I've never, you know, now he's going to die, and I've never tried to really talk to him about what maybe I understand or don't understand from my studies about what might or might not happen at the time of death. But I thought, oh, maybe I should try to say something just in case. So I picked up the phone and called him, and he was very receptive. I prefaced it, I don't know if you're interested, but I didn't want to, you know, never try to talk about it. But I wanted to try to talk to him in non-Buddhist language, so I tried to find everyday language to present it to him with. So I said something to him like, you know that sense inside of you where you always feel you've always been the same to yourself, like when you were 20 or 40 or 60 or 80, that if you close your eyes and when you're going to sleep or if you're, you know, out for a walk or something, that your sense of yourself is it's still you. It hasn't, like, the body might be changing, but if you try to put your finger on that. On that sense, it's very hard to find. It's kind of transparent or invisible, that feeling, and yet it's there. I said, what the Buddhists seem to say is that if you can learn to relax your mind into that kind of invisible, transparent space where you are, who you've always been, that you can ride that out as you die. And he was, okay, darling, I'll try. that was the last real conversation that we had. But it was a good, it felt like.
That was his last word?
He went on to, they insisted on biopsying the tumor, even though there was nothing to do about it. And then he got an infection from the biopsy, and then he dropped into a coma, and that's how he died, instead of, he was in the hospital. I have a younger brother who's more of a scientist than I am, who was with him. And his last words were, he was with my brother, and he was like, well, John, I feel really grateful for, and my brother thought he was going to say, you know, for my children and my family. He's like, I feel really grateful for all the wonderful fellows that I, the young doctors who I've been able to train. So that's where his love was, you know. So he was going to the right place. I want to come back. I'm going to stop after. I have two more things, if I'm not taking too much time. I want to come back to poetry and a little more. Starting with the anxiety, depression, and addiction piece that many of us grow up having, you know, like coming into our minds, that's what we have is anxiety, or that's what we find ourselves acting out is addiction, or that's what we feel is depression and we don't understand, but we're kind of gripped by it, and then we have a lifetime of psychotherapy or of meditation or of AA or just of drowning ourselves or starving ourselves or whatever we might do trying to figure it out. So this is about a poet named Louise Gluck, whose work I didn't know before I read this piece in The New Yorker, but it really moved me, and then I got a little more familiar with her work. So I'm just going to read you some bits and pieces about the poet Louise Gluck. She was born in 1943 in New York City and was raised on Long Island. A sister died before Gluck was born. Her death was not my experience, but her absence was, Gluck writes in an essay. Her death let me be born. That severity of judgment is typical of her. She often pares experience down to brutal cause and effect. Gluck sought her mother's approval exclusively, approval that was usually withheld. Her father, who had helped bring the X-Acto knife to market, was a worldly success with buried literary ambitions. A younger sister appears in Gluck's poems, sometimes as an ally, often as rival. Much of life for Gluck is livable only when hostile factions lay aside their arms. It is a view of social life as driven not by altruism, but by truce, and it was formed in that home. When she was 16, Gluck, suffering from anorexia, nearly starved herself to death. Her formal schooling was sporadic from that moment forward. She spent 7 years in psychoanalysis, but that's a short amount of time, and eventually apprenticed herself to two poets, first Leonie Adams, then Stanley Kunitz, both of whom she met during a brief period at Columbia. Anorexia seems to have been a clumsy early form of writing poetry, focusing exclusively and therefore tragically on form. Analysis, which replaced anorexia by describing it, would then be an improvement, except that it had no form. Its truths were inert and abstract. Only in poetry could the formal manifestations of insight be explored, a fact that she explores in form in a section of an essay called, or a poem called, Dedication to Hunger. This is her poem, part of the poem. It begins quietly in certain female children, the fear of death, taking as its form dedication to hunger. Because a woman's body is a grave, it will accept anything. I remember lying in bed at night, touching the soft, digressive breasts, touching at 15 the interfering flesh that I would sacrifice until the limbs were free of blossom and subterfuge. I felt what I feel now aligning these words. It is the same need to perfect, of which death is a mere byproduct. I could read it again, but I'll go on. So now the person is writing the essay about her. Blossom is what grown-ups say little girls' bodies do. To the girls, it feels more like subterfuge. The pair of words reveals so much about what drove Gluck in poems like this one, the need to perfect, certainly, but what poet doesn't feel some version of that need? Gluck's provocative difference was to link perfection with forms of defiance, as she writes in another essay, Education of the Poet. By the time I was 16, a number of things were clear to me. It was clear that what I had thought of as an act of will, an act I was perfectly capable of controlling, of terminating, was not that. I realized that I had no control over this behavior at all. And I realized, logically, that to be 85, then 80, then 75 pounds was to be thin. I understood that at some point I was going to die. Even then, dying seemed like a pathetic metaphor for establishing a separation between myself and my mother. So this is it. It's not just anorexia, like I think any kind of addiction, this sense that, oh, you're doing it on purpose, but then at some point you realize that actually you don't have control over your behavior at all, and that in fact you're acting out something and you don't even know what it is. And then the effort of therapy or of even of meditation practice or certainly of writing, of poetry, is to try to make some kind of sense of oneself, which she is doing. So here's another one of her poems. As I saw it, all my mother's life, my father held her down, like lead strapped to her ankles. She was buoyant by nature. She wanted to travel, go to theater, go to museums. What he wanted was to lie on the couch with the Times over his face so that death, when it came, wouldn't seem a significant change. And then this is the end of the essay. There's plenty to be sad about in Gluck's recent work. We expect her to be adept at delivering bad news. But all that severity is paying some tremendous dividends now in a poet who has been on record about misery all along. These new poems are funny, abundantly social, and often, where we expect a bitter judgment, merciful. Here she is in Fugue, remembering a child's game of family. I was the man because I was taller. My sister decided when we should eat. From time to time, she'd have a baby. Later in the same poem, she tells a dream. I had a dream my mother fell out of a tree. After she fell, the tree died. It had outlived its function. And in Crossroads, one of many sublime lyrics, after a lifetime of combating her body, she makes the most unlikely truce of all. My body, now that we will not be traveling together much longer, I begin to feel a new tenderness toward you, very raw and unfamiliar, like what I remember of love when I was young. So I think that's what we can hope for, at the very least. And can I read one more thing?
Yeah, why not?
All right. Are you okay with all this?
Yeah.
Okay. So just today I got this book by, do you know who Karlov Navsgard is?
Yes.
You know Karlov Navsgard? Norwegian writer of a six-volume series called My Struggle, where he details every moment of his, every moment edited as a novel of his growing up and having children and his alcoholic father and his depressed mother and his own. Anyway, he has a new book that just came out called Spring, where he's writing to his newborn baby. I just read the beginning of it today, and it's wonderful, so I'll read it to you, because I don't think you will have seen it yet. He's writing to his three-month-old. You don't know what air is, yet you breathe. You don't know what sleep is, yet you sleep. You don't know what night is, yet you lie in it. You don't know what a heart is, yet your own heart beats steadily in your chest, day and night, day and night, day and night. You are 3 months old, and as if swaddled in routines, you lie on a bed of sameness through the days. For you don't have a cocoon like larvae do. You don't have a pouch like the kangaroos. You don't have a den like the badgers or the bears. You have your bottle of milk. You have the changing table with nappies and wet wipes. You have the pram with the pillow and the duvet. You have your parents' large, warm bodies. Surrounded by all this, you grow so slowly that no one notices, least of all yourself. For first you grow outwards by gripping and holding on to the things around you with your hands, your mouth, your eyes, your thoughts, thereby bringing them into being. And only when you have done this for a few years and the world has been constituted do you begin to discover all that grips you, and you grow inwardly too, towards yourself. What is the world like to a newborn baby? Light, dark, cold, warm, soft, hard, the whole array of objects in a house, all meaning deriving from the relations within a family, the significance that every person dwells within, all this is invisible, hidden not by the darkness but by the light of the undifferentiated. Someone once told me that heroin is so fantastic because the feelings it awakens are akin to those we have as children when everything is taken care of, the feeling of total security we bask in then, which is so fundamentally good. Anyone who has experienced that high wants to experience it again, since they know it exists as a possibility. The life I live is separated from yours by an abyss. It is full of problems, of conflicts, of duties, of things that have to be taken care of, handled, fixed, of wills that must be satisfied, wills that must be resisted and perhaps wounded, all in a continual stream where almost nothing stands still, but everything is in motion, and everything has to be parried. I am 46 years old, and that is my insight, that life is made up of events that have to be parried, and that the moments of happiness in life all have to do with the opposite. What is the opposite of parrying something? It isn't to regress, it isn't to withdraw into your world of light and dark, warm and cold, soft and hard, nor is it the light of the undifferentiated. It is neither sleep nor rest. The opposite of parrying is creating, making, adding something that wasn't there before. You were not there before. Love is not a word I often use. It seems too big in relation to the life I live, the world I know. But then I grew up in a culture that was careful with words. My mother has never told me she loves me, and I have never told her I love her. The same goes for my brother. If I were to say to my mother or my brother that I love them, they would be horrified. I would have laid a burden on them, violently upsetting the balance between us, almost as if I had staggered around in a drunken fit during a child's christening. When you were born, I knew nothing about you, yet I was filled with feelings for you, overwhelming at first, for a birth is overwhelming, even to someone who is merely looking on. It is as if everything in the room grows denser, as if a kind of gravity develops that draws all meaning towards it, so that for a few hours it can only be found there, later becoming more evenly spread out, subjected to the everyday, diluted with the eventlessness of all the hours of the day, and yet always there. I am your father, and you know my face, my voice, and my ways of holding you. But beyond that, I could be anyone to you, filled with anything. My own father, your grandfather, who is dead, spent his last years with his mother, and their existence was pitiless. He was an alcoholic and had regressed. He no longer had the strength to parry anything. He had let everything slide, just sat there drinking. That he did so in his mother's home is significant. She had given birth to him. She had cared for him and carried him here and there, made sure he was warm, dry, fed. The bond this created between them was never broken. He tried, I know that, but he couldn't do it. That's why he stayed there. There he could let himself go to ruin. No matter how crippled, no matter how hideous, it was also love. Somewhere deep within there was love, unconditional love. He goes on, I'll stop there. You can see how good it is. Or I think it is anyway. So that we are, and you'll hear from Sharon and from Bob about this, we're here to evoke some version of that feeling that he's writing about, which is intrinsic to all of our natures, intrinsic to all of our beings, whether you know it or not. And if you make a little room, as we already started doing at the beginning, you just might come in contact with it. And I hope you do. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Do you need to stretch? You okay? You want to stand up for a moment? I guess you don't. You can if you want to. And you can sit down again, too. You don't have to leave unless you do have to leave. If you have to leave, that's okay. But
yeah, sure.
Okay. How many of you, I'm curious, how many of you are coming tomorrow? Okay. Because, of course, tomorrow we have quite a lot more time for practice and questions and things like that, which will be really good. I'm also really curious, how many of you were drawn to one or all of the words anxiety, depression, and addiction? Is that why you're here? And I can't even quite remember the other three. It's release, understanding, and
love. Release.
Love. Oh,
love.
I forgot love.
That was
really scary. See, I couldn't even remember love. How many of you were drawn to one or all of those three words? Because something in the nature of the Buddhist training, certainly of the Theravadin school in which I was so largely trained, really tends to emphasize the problem. It's almost like the motto is, let's get real. And what's real for most people is the direct experience of the problem, and that's where we start. It's with that honest and open and loving experience of what the problem is. But I always remember I wrote one book called Real Happiness at Work. And the first time I met with the editor, we were just in like a Pan Quotidian somewhere near here. And she said to me, what do you want the chapter headings to be? In other words, what do you want the table of contents to look like? And I said, oh, how about like burnout and exhaustion and moral injury? And she looked absolutely horrified. And she said, how about like balance and integrity and, you know, whatever. And I said, that's, yeah, that's like what I said, you know. But, and for me, there is something so reassuring about words like addiction, anxiety, and depression. Because for one thing, it tends to be a feeling of inclusion, you know, rather than if you were to experience one or all of those conditions, to feel that you're somehow marginalized or left out or excluded, the stigma of that, right away, that's a declaration. You know, to say, okay, this is around which we are gathering. And there's also the invitation, of course, to be different with all of these things. Because the purpose of that kind of exploration is not to just kind of go round and round and round and round the same experiences we have every day, but to see what it's like when we approach with love and release and understanding, and what that different framework, that different context, that different holding environment, which I learned from Mark in terms of beyond, you know, what does that do? So I also thought of in Buddhist teaching where they so often talk about these three main roots of our suffering: grasping, aversion, and delusion. Grasping, holding on, clinging, attachment, aversion being anger and fear in some schools, and delusion being, in this context, sort of being cut off and being confused, being spaced out, you know, not connecting to what your experience is. And I thought about this time when I was working on a book on faith called Faith, and everything in my mind, everything in the world as I was seeing it in those days, was about faith. And I thought about those three tendencies of holding on and pushing away and that kind of spaced out, numbing out, as being really ways of having misplaced faith or misplaced trust. Something in us, in those states, lost in those states, believes that if we could only hold on hard enough, we would have it. You know, we would have a sense of wholeness, we'd have a sense of peace, we'd feel complete, we wouldn't ever need anything ever again. And so we cling out of that kind of mistaken notion. And so too with that feeling that somehow if we can push away that which is painful, we'll be in control, we'll have mastered things, we'll have proven our worth, that we'll be able to keep unpleasant things from arising again, ever. And somehow also with that kind of delusion or numbness or spaced out things, it's kind of comforting in a lot of cases, you know, not to feel and just to zone and be sort of skating on the surface like that, and to be in that little cocoon where you're kind of nestled in, you know, and cut off. And we think, okay, that's the resolution, that's the answer. And just so, I think of anxiety or depression or addiction in some ways as these manifestations of this deep, deep yearning we all have as human beings to be happy, to be free, to have a sense of belonging, to feel a part of, to find a home somewhere, you know, in this body, in this mind, in with other people, on this earth, somewhere. But of course, it's all interlaced with not knowing, with not understanding, with myths we've been taught, lies we've been told, you know, our own mistaken notions. And so we also confuse that yearning for the problem, but I think the yearning is the point, that that's appropriate. It's not something to feel squeamish about or, you know, embarrassed about. It's appropriate. It's rightful. It's right to want to be happy. People often say, I don't know, you know, like, it seems to me that, you know, my generosity is really tainted, as an example, because I know that if I'm generous, I'll be happier, and therefore it's not a pure act. It's really selfish. It's really for my own happiness. And I always say, well, that's not greed. That's science. That's like having figured out something about the universe. You know, if you withhold and you're withdrawn and you can't connect and you can't give and you never relinquish anything and you're, you know, just holding on, you're not very happy. That's true. And if you connect and you care and you offer and you wish well to others and you give, you have a kind of generosity of the spirit and you thank people and you smile at people and you pay attention to people, you'd be a lot happier. That's also true. If you figured it out, you know, that's good. Like, wouldn't have to shy away from that. And so, you know, the main thing I was thinking of for tonight and emphasizing was, first of all, honoring that wish to be happy. And to see that not as a problem. But in some ways, when that urge toward happiness, or we could call it yearning, is aligned with wisdom instead of with ignorance, it can really be our homing instinct for freedom. We can cut through many, many obstacles. And when we're caught in something, we're caught. You know, a story we've told ourselves, a story others have told us about us that we now believe, a story about where happiness is to be found, where strength is to be found, where courage is and daring and, you know, being bold and different. And does it always have to be kind of painful? You know, where do we find release? Where do we think relief will be? Is it in seeking control over what really could never be controlled? Or is it in being able to step back from that, you know, and being able to be with different kind of energies, even if they're sort of difficult? And just sometimes to actually almost play a game with yourself or have a kind of session of active imagination. It's kind of interesting, like, where do I believe happiness is to be found? And what do I feel strength lies within? And what makes me distinct and have something to give? There have been many times when I've been asked a gazillion times, you know, I don't know if I should really get balanced. I don't know if I should really meditate much because I'm an artist and I need, I think, to be tortured in order to create. it needs to come from that place. And, or I, you know, I'm extremely ambitious in the world and I don't want to lose my edge. I think if I were to be balanced, I would just be sort of like inert, you know, and vegetative, and I'd be, you know, mellow enough, but, you know, just be like there, lying there. and not getting much done. And, you know, where does creativity come from, really? You know, where does accomplishment come from, really? One of my favorite stories these days is this time I almost kind of ruined this young woman's life for a while, where I was co-leading this six-day seminar, and on the first night I was speaking, and I talked about how, you know, there's such a ridiculous saying that it's a dog-eat-dog world, and just, I mean, it's a ridiculous saying, but many of us are taught to believe it. That's the kind of myth that we get fed, you know, that you can't rely on anyone else, can't count on anyone else, no one's going to help you, you know, so you don't help anybody else. It's all up to you, just forge ahead, doesn't matter how many people you crush, doesn't matter how alone you feel, right? Just keep going. It's a dog-eat-dog world. And this young woman came up to the microphone and she said, I never knew that was the saying. She said, I always thought the saying was, it's a dog-eat-dog world, like D-O-G-G-Y-D-O-G, you know, like puppies in meadows jumping up and down. She said, that's horrible. It's a dog-eat-dog world. So then, it is horrible. So then 6 days went by, and it was the end of the program, and it was like the closing circle. So she came up to the microphone again, and she said, I refuse to live in a dog-eat-dog world. I'm going to live in a dog-eat-dog world. So, I mean, just to peel away, because this is not just a kind of internal process in the sense of, you know, a kind of singularly created sense of things we reach for, you know, pushing away people or going faster so it doesn't catch up to us, whatever it is, or, you know, not letting ourselves feel, whatever it might be. It's born of many conditions, right? There are many contributing factors to that. And Mark brought all these great books to read. I didn't bring the book that I'm about to read. But I don't know, probably five times in the last 2 days, people have brought it up. This book called Lost Connections. Did you read it?
Not yet.
Did you hear it? I don't know what you'll end up thinking about it, but the subtitle is something like The Real Cause of Depression.
What?
It's called Lost Connections, The Real Cause of Depression.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Oh. Antidepressants don't work.
Yeah, well, that is another thing, but that I don't necessarily agree with. But, you know, it's about connection and how we are so phenomenally lonely these days, by and large, because the old ways we used to connect have kind of dissolved in so many ways. And we don't have that kind of social fabric or network that would once sustain us so that, you know, there was a way of expressing yourself. Even if you, I don't know, even if you felt crummy, for example, maybe you could help out somebody else within that community. And there was a way that you then felt a different sense of worth and something like that. And those things are not so prevalent anymore. And so here we are, you know, not only needing to try to find solutions from within, but looking at creating systems and patterns and networks and ways of being with one another that will actually make a difference with all of these things, because the suffering is phenomenal. And the irony, of course, is that nobody sets out to suffer more. You know, we set out to feel a whole lot better than we feel. And we just fall into these patterns and these ways of being that are so often so destructive or damaging. And so understanding is a huge thing. And the ability to step back from one's patterns instead of either hating them or falling into them, just to step back and take a look is a huge thing. And this is what we really we talk about when we talk about mindfulness. It's so much fun for me to be here with Bob and Mark, Dr. Bob and Dr. Mark. And there have been, I don't know, countless times when I've sat up here with Dr. Mark, for example, and he talks about D.W. Winnicott, whom he did not talk about today, as one of his great influencers, who is a psychoanalyst, right, in the 50s. And one of Dr. Winnicott's famous sayings was, just be a good enough mother. Just be a good enough mother. And in response to the gender difference, Mark says, I'm going to quote Mark throughout this story, Mark says, well, it was the 50s in Great Britain, the people who were presenting with the kids were the mothers. So let's say, be a good enough parent. And somebody always raises their hands and says, well, what's a good enough parent? And Mark says, somebody who can survive their child's rage. And then somebody raises their hand and says, what does it mean to survive your child's rage? And then Mark says, neither be like invasive and controlling, nor distant and rejecting.
Not to retaliate and not to abandon.
To abandon and not to like retaliate, thank you. You know, and it's just this place in the middle where you can be with in a very different way. And then I always say, that's mindfulness. That's what we call mindfulness. You know, to be with in a very different way. So as we embark on this kind of path of discovery, always keeping in mind and honoring that wish to be happy, and we see probably many things that we try and that we assume and that we're attached to and that are not really fulfilling. It's always in that light, you know, of holding this in a very different way. And just so, we also see those courageous shoots, you know, that come forth when we do try, or we do look at things differently, or the fact that we, you know, come to a place like this and it's hot, and that's okay. You know, we're okay enough, and things like that. And so I want to keep coming back to that quality and that difference, that holding environment, that way of seeing, that different way of being with what we discover, because what we discover will be very varied and different in many ways, both the glorious attributes that we have and some really difficult places as well. Okay, so I think that's it for now. Dr. Bob?
Oh. Okay. Thank you. Dr. Sharon.
Thank you.
She's a doctor too. Mark and I conferred a doctorate on her at Menla, our upstate center, because we both felt that, you know, if we're going to be doctors, she should also be a doctor. That, you know, what does it mean to be a doctor, you know? A doctor of philosophy, what does that mean? That's really, I don't know. At least you actually have people who are a little more miserable than yourself, I think. But I wanted to ask people, how many people today had a moment of pure joy? Look at these happy campers.
Yeah.
No wonder Mark likes to tell you about what? Anxiety?
Mm-hmm.
Depression? Well, trauma is, you know, everyday trauma.
We haven't even talked about trauma yet.
Yeah, but trauma is everyday. But then
trauma's
we know that's
tomorrow.
What?
Trauma's tomorrow.
But what was
addiction.
The title? Was what? Anxiety? Depression?
Anxiety, addiction.
Addiction.
And depression.
And depression. Mm-hmm. And then?
Love.
Relief.
Love, relief.
Love, relief.
And?
Understanding.
Understanding.
Understanding. But which is which of the three of us?
Well, Sharon's relief.
Sharon's relief.
Sharon's
oh,
relief.
Thank goodness.
Your love.
No.
And I'm understanding.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No. No, 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 no. I don't think so.
Dr. Love.
So I was just cheered up. Everybody was looking pretty serious. everybody does look serious, you know, and then everyone had a moment of pure joy today.
Not quite everyone.
So, what?
Not quite everyone.
Most of them. A lot of hands went up. And therefore, those who had that feeling of pure joy, you know, Mark, you said early on saying that I was supposed to disagree with you. Yeah. About how after you have something or other, and then you're going to be the same as you always were.
Right.
Right? You said that.
Yeah.
So, but really, what did you mean by that? You know? Then you also said this thing about how, you know, you sort of find in there something that always seems to be the same.
Mm-hmm.
You were telling your dad.
Yeah.
And he was about to pass out.
Mm.
And definitely, that's a situation where you drop out from feeling that you're that same point of you is in charge of things. You know, death is the ultimate one of those, you know, the ultimate one. But actually, we all experience that right away. You know, I'm always very worried about people who think they're enlightened. To me, that's a very worrisome condition. And I know a few of them, actually. And it's really problematic because then, you know, you have to convince yourself that everything you do is just really great, unless you redefine enlightenment as meaning nothing different. And then I guess you can get away with it. In other words, if you think that therefore being enlightened means that you continue to be really stupid. Well, you know, that's my excuse. You know, my excuse is about understanding, you know. Well, you didn't put happiness in there at all. You know? Relief, you said. Relief. Well, relief is happiness, right?
Yeah, love is
Buddha
happiness.
Buddha was careful. Well, no, love is not happiness. Love is wishing happiness on the people who you
and
see as less unhappy.
Isn't that a state of happiness?
But that's right. But you're right, and people don't say that. You know, in other words, people mix up love with longing for the happiness of the beloved, and they feel that it's based on somehow ignoring your own misery. And then that way you can be loving, because then you just care about the other one being happy. But then they need you to feel that they're happy. So in a way, you are perceiving them as sharing your misery to start with. So then you sort of lock them into misery by loving them, by wishing they were somehow other than they were, than they are. Really, you're joining them in their misery, basically. So isn't it nice when someone comes along, I love you. What do you think about me? They tend to do that, right? And then they feel that the beloved is supposed to make them happy. So this is what people feel too guilty to say. When they feel that moment of pure joy. Now, when you all felt that moment of pure joy, come on, all of you felt one. Everybody felt a moment of pure joy. And then you looked around nervously because you were, what terrible thing is going to follow on that? Because you're brainwashed that joy is illegal. And it's unreasonable. And the real story is misery. I mean, look at the government that we have, you know. And not just us, you know. Then there's like Syria. There's all these terrible things. Then there's all the past distractions and Holocaust and horrible genocides and oh, God knows what. Someone sent a picture. I had a picture on my phone today in between airplanes. I was in Chicago, you know, hoping to catch my, and expecting a miracle of my bag being shifted from one plane to another in 37 minutes. Which it did.
Yeah.
It did it. I
it's
couldn't
a miracle.
Believe it. And that was a moment of joy. Although that was only because I was ignoring what is in my bag, which is a bunch of dirty clothes. Which have to be washed, you know. So, no, but I had a phone. There was a beautiful baby on that. So I was thinking, okay, welcome another baby. But that baby had died.
Mm.
Very shortly thereafter. But it was so pretty and beautiful. It had some kind of tumor or something, and then just quick, they would try and everything, and it died. Mm. So why did they send that to me? To our thing, you know? I guess Bardo, you know? Then, you know, you get older, and a lot of your friends are croaking madly around you, and then they want you, then they want to work on the Bardo. How many people think they're going to have a future life in here? How many people? Not as many as had pure joy. Not as many as had pure joy. You know, so you know, I love to ask my scientific materialist friends. Nowadays, one of my favorite things to ask them is, could they tell me, I'm so ignorant in the history of science, I'm a humanist, you know. You know, the humanities side of the faculties, you know. They're the ones the least paid. And they're not in the STEM thing that everybody wants everyone to do, you know. You know, what, engineering. And okay, never mind. So the point is that I asked them, well, who discovered that there's no future life? That when you die, you become nothing. Your consciousness becomes nothing. Who discovered that? Was that Newton? Was it Descartes? Was it... Who's the one who gets the award for discovering the nothing that awaits you? Because you're a scientist and you go on what has been discovered and experienced, right? It's because you don't go on blind faith, think that's a god, you know, the crazy things, you know, burning bushes and weird things. And you don't believe any of that. You believe what people have experienced, right? So who was it who experienced the nothing after death? And celebrated in the annals of science. Can anyone tell me? Anyone in the room? Of the many of you who didn't hold up your hand and don't expect to have a future continuation after death, who discovered that and reported it as scientific fact? I mean, when you go, when you have a headache, you, scientifically it's okay to take a leave or an aspirin or something, right? Or Jethro Klaus wants you to put your feet in a hot water. That takes the blood out of your head. That's a, it's a cheaper way. And if you have a water heater. And so who discovered that? I love to ask them. And then they kind of don't get my point because they look like, well, who needs to discover? It's obvious, you know. It's totally obvious. And then I say, well, did Carl Sagan show up and inform us in the epilogue to Cosmos that there's that he doesn't exist and therefore it's cool? Is anybody? Who's going to show up and tell? Oh, what?
Cosmo Topper.
What?
Cosmo Topper.
Cosmo Topper?
Yeah.
What's Cosmo Topper?
Cosmo's Hopper?
Marion.
What?
George and Marion, the ghosts that came back to Cosmo
Topper. I don't know that. Oh, I don't know that. You know, I mean the thing, the science thing, you know. But the wonderful billions and billions and, the, you know, like that one, you know. Carl Sagan. Maybe younger people don't know that. I'm sorry. I don't know
young
about Cosmo Topper
like
myself. But I'm just saying that's a blind faith belief. Totally. Because no one obviously discovered nothing. And actually your common sense will tell you no one ever will. How about that? You pass out every night when you go to sleep. Right? So you've already disappeared. Many times, that continuum that, if you know, your dad was going to experience at death, where his continuum of the unchanging subjectivity, was he already experienced that zillion times every night he fell asleep, mm-hmm. right? And then you do have a dream and you wake up, something seems to continue, doesn't it? And has any, can you point to anything in nature that becomes nothing? Has anybody managed? Can you point to nothing? Anybody? Gee whiz. Newsflash. Nothing is nothing. Therefore, you can't get in it. You can't enter it. You can't land in it. It isn't there. So everything you've ever experienced is something. You pass out and then you wake up again. And you have a dream. So you want to make a revised opinion? How many of you expect to continue after death? Oh, another thing, I wasn't being tricky tonight. How many of you are afraid of nothing? There, it's a couple of hands. Usually I get a lot of hands on that one. Many people. Then I say, if a real life Rambo stood up here and said, I ain't afraid of nothing, what would you think that meant? That would mean they were not afraid, right? So how can you manage to be afraid of nothing? Isn't that a little bit nutty? A little bit nutty. But there were only a couple of brave people held up their hands. I know that. So the piece about love is, to be truly loving, you have to be aware of your own joy. You have to be, it has to be based on some kind of bliss of your own. And then you then want to share that. Don't you think logically that's the case? Because otherwise, and then you have to be able to see other beings as potentially happy. Well, you said you see them as all right, somebody asked you?
Yeah.
So what does it mean to see them as all right? Mm-hmm. It means to see that there's some happiness in them. Or look at you, or you're looking up here, you're thinking, your mind is working. You're like, is it relief or addiction? You know, and you're thinking that, and you're pleased with yourself. God, all these spare parts. You get older, you have a lot of spare parts. And you have joy. You know what joy is. You all know that. You're healthy. You're sitting there. You know, look, Mark is enjoying one leg being over the other. The thigh, this part of the thigh feels happy on that part of the thigh. So you're like happy there. That's the kind of joy. Your leg has a joy sitting there, right? But we don't pay attention to that because we're worrying about some other thing, you know? So when you say you will be like you always were, mm-hmm. then that means you are some way that you don't admit to yourself that you are, mm-hmm. doesn't it? There's an aspect of ourselves that we don't have access to that actually knows better than we do. I'm quite proud of myself nowadays about one thing, several things, but one thing in particular. When I got my PhD at Harvard and I handed my dissertation to only two guys in my department, lucky for me, there were only two people. And I wrote, instead of writing for partial fulfillment of the requirements for a degree in Buddhist studies in the Department of Sanskrit and Indian Studies, I didn't write that. I was about to write, because that's what I should have written, Buddhist studies. But I didn't. I wrote Buddhology, which didn't exist at Harvard, and still doesn't, I'm sure. And I don't know why I did that. I just did it, you know. Maybe it sounded more Germanic or something. I mean, I have no idea. I didn't have an idea. And then the chairman of the department talked to my advisor. He says, Maas, do we have a subfield here called Buddhology? And my friend, the slight Japanese guy, you know, he says, well, Dan, we do now. Which was so great, but I'm very proud of that. Why? In my field, in all academia, Buddhist studies means studying some weird things that some strange pre-modern people did, following around some weird guy who didn't know that he was just going to be the way he always was. And he was wearing an orange toga and barefoot and going around asking for a free lunch here and there. But they know for sure that he wasn't enlightened. And how do they know that? He didn't have a PhD from Harvard. And they do. And that makes them enlightened. Because they have all the knowledge of our great civilization and are really modern, and they know that they don't have to worry about future life, and they know like all kinds of things, and they know about depression and alleviation and addiction and non-addiction. They know all kinds of things. And he didn't know about any of that. Right? Buddha didn't know about some guy shooting up on heroin, the opioid epidemic, did he? He couldn't have. They didn't have syringes at that time. Right? So he couldn't have been enlightened. And he wasn't presiding over a planet that is destroying itself by the human beings in it who don't care to turn down the light switch. and or maybe have a nuclear war, or discover impermanence in the atom, and if there's infinite energy in every atom, and we could all vaporize instantaneously given the right chain reaction right here now sitting in this room. Or the Dalai Lama, my favorite is Dalai Lama is so naughty. When he received the Templeton Prize in St. Paul's Cathedral in London, and after he had to listen to 1 hour of boring speeches before he got up to give his acceptance, and by that time he was so tired he didn't want to give a speech, so what he wanted to do was give away the money he had earned, and his secretary wouldn't give him the briefcase with the check in it. Because he got $1.7 million and gave $1.5 to Save the Children Foundation to give to malnourished children in India, and $200,000 to the Mind and Life group, you know, to keep talking about science so they can discover ethics, which was his purpose in talking with them. And they wouldn't let him do it. So then he had to give a speech. So then he's there, and there's all this pomposity had gone on for 1 hour, and it's Gothic like English marble at St. Paul's Cathedral. So what does he do? He looks up at the Gothic arches, this big, magnificent English cathedral, and he says, "This is an amazing building. It's wonderful," he said. "Although I understand Hitler once found the range." Can you believe that?
Once found the range?
Once found
what? Yeah, the B-1 bombers blasted it once.
Oh.
So subliminal, and of course it's the kind of thing nobody noticed. The Dalai Lama didn't say that. I didn't hear that. But subliminally, the roof was lifted off. Impermanence ensued, a subtle perception of impermanence on everybody's part. So everybody felt a little bit relieved, you know. Like, so I like to do that too, you know. And when I, especially when I give a speech, not in New York, everybody here is so blasé, but I love to give it when I give a talk in Kansas or in Missouri or Mississippi. I talk about how Buddha met God. Don't think Buddhists don't believe in God. Buddha met God. It's in the Pali Suttas. All those gods are talking to Buddha all the time. He met God. And then, you know, when he was one of his disciples was seeking the reality, the truth. And the disciple asked God, he said, "Look, you're God, you know, and I hear you made the whole thing, you know, and I want to ask you how you did it and what is its reality, because you made it, so you should know." And God answered, "Do you have an appointment? I'm very busy. I'm God." So he went on like that. So finally, after a while, God left. He left. He said, "Okay, God, I'm sorry to bother you, you know," and Brahma is the name of that creator at that culture, and he left, and then Brahma came out by miraculous teleportation, and was, before he was leaving, his subtle body was leaving Brahma's heaven, and then Brahma said, "Actually, I have to tell you the truth. I didn't create it. I don't know how it works, and I want you to get Buddha to tell people that, because I don't like them being angry with me when horrible things happen to them. I was just the first guy who showed up here. I was like a big deal, and I don't know what's going on." I love to tell that story in the Midwest, because there's a silence that ensues in the room, and then people are waiting for the lightning bolt to strike me, and so far it hasn't hit. And then there's this palpable wave of relief. It's all subliminal in the audience. Gee whiz, he said such a terrible thing, and he survived, and he's grinning. Okay, what is this? And then they feel a little more relaxed, you know, until that following Sunday. So, that's the point. Right now, no. So the point is, right now, in some sense, you know, you and I and all of us, we're not even a bunch of atoms. You know, a scientist would tell us that we see faces and surfaces and light and concrete and things, but actually the reality of it is all these particles. And they are zapping around and nobody knows what they're doing. And even they blow them up in big expensive machines, and they come up with the Higgs boson, and they feel, oh, okay, there's something underlying mass. And then they make a big newspaper article, and they get another $20 billion to build another one. to blow more things up. And then in the bottom of the newspaper article, the last few sentences, they say, well, the other thing, though, is that all of this is only 3% of the matter in the universe. And 97% of it is dark matter and dark energy, and we haven't seen that yet. Because it's dark. The 97% of it they haven't seen yet. How many cyclotrons do they want us to pay for before they somehow come up with what 90% of it is? They have no idea. It's the big standard theory, big bang and all this kind of thing and all that, and there's no nothing, and you're going to be nothing, though. And I mean, come on, these people are a bunch of psychos. Seriously. Here we are, but we're all sitting here and talking, but our reality, even from the materials, is just like this, and we don't have minds, we don't have brains, we're already not here. We already don't exist. There's no continuum. Shoot yourself and you'll be nothing, any of you who think you won't continue. Well, it's very simple. Just, you don't have to go to a Zen center and meditate and stare at the wall for like 6 months or 6 years or 60 years. Just shoot yourself, then you're nothing. And that's what but we're not nothing, okay? We're here. And therefore, it could be a lot worse. As Garrison Keillor used to say before he was exiled for manhandling. It could be worse. So therefore, we're all happy, actually. We're completely happy. We're over here, you know, listening to Sharon and Mark, and I'm annoying you and them. And look, you're like smiling, and your body's holding together, and you know what? Why it is? Because your under thigh there likes your upper thigh there, and so you're happy to cross your legs. And your body is happy with itself. And if you let your gloominess get into your body, you know what that is. That you'll be ill. So you're made of bliss, actually. That's what Buddha discovered. Don't give me this. It doesn't take a Buddha to discover suffering. The Indians are not stupid. If some guy announced, hey, this is all suffering, they would say, what is he? Simple-minded, he never stubbed his toe. He never, like, cut his finger, like he didn't like lose his girlfriend, or he had like a number of them, but you know, they didn't annoy him. Of course, that's not what Buddha discovered. Buddha discovered bliss, the third noble truth, but he was clever like a psychiatrist. He didn't call it bliss, he called it relief. Because he knew he wouldn't get arrested for talking about relief. If he talked about bliss, they'd all suspect him. Seriously. But relief is bliss, don't you think? Relief of suffering is bliss. What else is bliss? And that's how you have to see people if you're going to see them as well. And you're going to have to see that actually they know that, or they wouldn't show up at your office. But they are convinced that it's really not right, it's not good enough, and this and that. And then in our culture, it's terrible because there's no former life. And therefore, everything wrong gets blamed on mom and dad. They just did it wrong. They didn't read Dr. Spock. They didn't read Winnicott. So they weren't good enough moms. They just were pain, you know. They did this, and now I'm neurotic, and it's all their fault. And luckily, you're going to be a better mom and a better dad for me, so then, you know, then you're helping me, you know. Anyway, I know. I don't want to go into it too much. But the point is, Buddha discovered bliss, and that's the relief, you know. And as love is on this side, understanding is on that side. You're so brilliant, Mark. Love is over here, understanding is over there, and in a way they're the same thing. Because if you understand yourself, you will count your blessings, and you'll find your bliss. You won't do like the New Yorker cartoon that I didn't like. Where they, you know, Joseph Campbell famously said to Bill Moyers, follow your bliss. Remember, I don't know if you remember that. Some of you will remember that. So they had a cartoon in the New Yorker 20 years later. And there was a guy out in front of a church who was panhandling with a tin cup. And he had a sign on his chest that said, I followed my bliss. He wanted a quarter, you know. to get a hot dog to go along with the bliss. You know? So that's the third noble truth. And that's real happiness.
Mm.
And it's not only, it's real happiness, period. I think it was the more fun one. And real real happiness at work.
Right, that wasn't as much
that
fun.
That was a little harder. And, you know, I was talking to some people just lately in Honolulu, and they were in a little gloomy mood because it was raining, and the volcano blew up on the island next door. But they're very worried about America, because pretty soon robots are going to be doing everything, and there's going to be no jobs. Much worse than now, they're blaming it on immigrants, and they're blaming it on globalization, and they're blaming it on whatever. But then finally, it's just there'll be no one left to blame it on, and then nobody will be work. And the one thing that this person was reporting to me, some conferences about that with Silicon Valley moguls and all the people talking about the robots, you know. And the truck drivers are all going to be out of work. What are we going to do with all the truck drivers being out of work? And truck stops will be depopulated. None of them had thought, how about changing the culture where you don't feel you have to work and you don't feel your worth is by working and sweating somewhere and suffering, but you can just have worth by being a human being. What would happen? How could that be? How could that be done? And of course, these people are all super workaholics, so they couldn't imagine that, so they didn't think of that as a solution. But that's what Buddhist monks do. Look at these Zen monks. Buddha, do you know how Buddha appeared to his mom? Do any of you know the legend? When she had a dream and this thing came to her, and if you saw little Buddha, it was stupidly rendered as she was dancing around in a garden with a weird-looking baby elephant. That's really dumb. What appeared to her was a white elephant. How does a white elephant come to mean a useless thing? Isn't that what it means in our culture, a white elephant? I wonder the trajectory of that in history.
White elephant.
Buddha appeared as a white elephant, a useless thing in the sense of normal production. If you don't produce, you're worthless, right? That's our culture. But we can easily change that, I think. And then what are they doing? Oh, welfare queens, you know, social system is bad. Oh, Scandinavia. Well, Scandinavians do tend to be depressed. They do. You know, over there. My dad was an alcoholic. They're all alcoholics. But that's because it's too cold all the time. You know, and it's very cold, and if you dilute your blood with alcohol, it doesn't bother you as much, you know. So they're medicating themselves, but unfortunately it has a bad effect on their liver, and they get depressed. Unless they can go to Spain, you know, in this winter, which they do. So bliss is it, okay? That's what Buddha discovered, not suffering. And he only mentioned suffering because he discovered bliss. Because when you suffer, it's because you're not fully aware of your own reality. And another thing we're all repressing in this culture is a lot of these how many of you have read a lot of near-death experience literature? Anybody? A bit? Of course, we were just doing this in Maui about death, you know. But, you know, one thing that I think people are nervous to read near-death experience is very often the near-death people, which means the sort of the ones who clinically die, kind of, but then come back, they usually don't want to come back. They're feeling blissful. And then some, you know, Jesus shows up, or a mentor, or a shaman, or some bodhisattva, and says, not your time, go back. And then, zoom, they go backward down the white light tunnel, and they're back on the operating table, and somebody's carving on them, you know, like, we're gonna put them back together again, you know, for the latest auto accident, you know. So in the Vimalakirti Sutra, I didn't bring the book, but I know it by heart. But the Vimalakirti Sutra, at one point in the sutra, Shariputra, who is the head monk, a Theravada monk, and it's getting to be noontime with all the wonderful emptiness conversations that's going on and the you know, nirvana conversations that's going on. And he thinks, you know, there's some old monks here, and if they don't eat before noon, they don't get to eat till tomorrow morning, because they really don't eat dinner. And that's really bad for their health, and this is really awful. So then typically Vimalakirti reads his mind and says, Shariputra, did you come here for lunch or for the Dharma? And very quickly, so of course, for the Dharma. So then Vimalakirti says, okay, but I'll send out for lunch. So Vimalakirti creates a golden emanation bodhisattva, a gopher bodhisattva. You know, a gopher, that expression. No, I don't mean the groundhog. I mean gopher. And he says, I want you to go to the universe of the Buddha Sarvaganda Suganda. In the universe Sarvaganda Suganda, the Buddha's name there is Suganda Kuta, mountain of perfume, of excellent perfume. And the universe is the piles of perfume. And bring the small, ask him for a small leftover from his lunch and bring it back here. So then this bodhisattva takes off. You know, he says he's in the eastern direction beyond as many universes as there are grains of sand in 62 Ganges river beds. He gives them like a distance finding. So the guy shoots out there at the speed of thought, asks that Buddha. Buddha gives him a few grains of perfume rice. Buddha's body is made of perfume. The land is perfume. The whole universe is perfume. It's a cloud galaxy thing. It's all living perfume. All the bodhisattvas are made of perfume. They sit under perfume trees, and they're in samadhi all the time. They're the ultimate meditation center, universe. Just everything is perfume. Mm-hmm. The teacher doesn't even have to talk. He just radiates a perfume.
Good.
So he takes these, and he comes back to feed the people. And then they make like a miracle, and they feed thousands of people. And then the bodhisattvas in that universe, they ask that Buddha, they say, wow, who's Vimalakirti? And who is Shakyamuni? And what kind of world is that where he sends out for takeout to our world? And he says, well, that's Shakyamuni Buddha, and that's in the Saha universe. And the name of our universe is Saha, which means tolerable.
I thought you said barely tolerable.
Barely tolerable.
Barely tolerable.
Is the idea, but it's just tolerable. Mm. So they say, we'd like to go see Vimalakirti, and what kind of weirdo is he? And they say, you can go, but you have to change your body, because you have samadhi power, you can teleport, but you have to change your body when you get there, because if those beings down there smelled you, they'd all go completely insane. They've never smelled such a smell like you, so just don't go there, you have to change. So then they come down, and Vimalakirti has a weird house like Doctor Who's house. Because thousands of people can go in this house. The dimension just adjusts. And they all come in the house. And they're looking around, they're going, ooh, what kind of world is this? What is wrong with Shakyamuni Buddha? He has the worst infrastructure we have ever imagined in a Buddhaverse, in a Buddha land. And then they say, and they have the feast, and all kinds of things happen. And eventually the Vimalakirti asked them about their universe and what it's like and how the Dharma is taught there by all pure perfume. And they tell him, we just smell perfume and then we go into samadhi, no problem. And then they ask Vimalakirti how the world is taught here, how the Dharma is taught here. And he starts reciting the Dharma. This is hell. This is the Preta realm. This is the animal realm. This is suffering. This is the suffering of the gods. This is the suffering of the titans. This is the suffering of humans. All this negative stuff. And they're like, what kind of weird world is this? And how come this guy is said to be a Buddha? And then Vimalakirti persuades him that our universe, which is barely tolerable, is much more efficient as an enlightenment-creating environment than that perfume one. Because in the perfume one, all they can do is develop wisdom and tranquility and just sit there. Because suffering is so remote from their experience. So their compassion becomes, withers, kind of. I mean, they have it, of course, because you have to have it when you expand and identify with other beings, and they're great yogis, but in a way it gets no exercise. Our universe, we have this divine intelligence, actually, from Buddha's point of view. We do have divine intelligence, but we're very vulnerable and we're kind of feeble. We can easily get confused and we can bang into things and we also do bang into each other and therefore we suffer. So therefore we can reach out to those who are suffering. And that reaching out with these fragile, soft skin and like not that effective, capable thing, and mentally also develops our compassion. And we evolve toward being what we always were, which is a being made of bliss, being aware that we're beings made of bliss, being aware that our Buddha nature is our real nature. We were just with Ram Dass in Maui, and he apparently was very interested, and he heard that I don't mind using the word soul.
Mm. I told him that.
Whoa. You told him? You did, the doctor is guilty of that. So, and you know, he was worried about Hinduism, Buddhism, you know, Paramatma, the supreme self, the supreme soul, and no soul. Those guys are running around with no soul. He was really upset about it. And you know, when I first came there, it was a slight nervousness, although he's an old friend of mine. I knew him since 1960, when he was Dr. Richard Alpert, driving around a green Mercedes, sort of a pea green, not a really jolly green, a pea green Mercedes convertible. And being Dr. Richard Alpert, and we used to cruise up next to him with our Mercedes, with our BSA super rocket motorcycles, and we were already stoned on much higher doses than he was. He had, and he would look at us like. Then he was blamed for us, but it wasn't his fault, and they fired him. But anyway, so who saved me from this worry about soul versus no soul? Yogi Berra. The great Dharma teacher called Yogi Berra. Do you know his great saying? If you come to a fork in the road, take it. You know that one? Actually, I'm going to look up. There must be a book of his other saying. I'm going to get him on my Kindle so I can have some more Yogi Berras. He really teaches the Dharma, Yogi Berra. Take that fork. Just take it. Isn't that good? That's how to deal with duality. Good and evil. Pain and pleasure, etc. Relief and suffering. Take it. Perfect. Really. So everybody was relaxed. And he, right, he said later, I'm with Yogi. Yep. And he waved at me over there. Right? You saw that. So my point is, Buddha also denies that a nose, an eye, an ear, you know, he negates everything when he's in his negating mode. So why pick on soul? You know why? Because early translators in Buddhism, they were trying to escape, like the scientists, from hellfire, you know, from preachers, from Christianity, the church, you know, which would send them all to hell if they had a little fun. Right? You know, Mark Twain, the reason everybody, you know, does sin is because heaven is presented to them like an eternal church social. And it's too boring, and that's why they do bad things. That was Mark Twain's theory. I think that's correct. So, point is that when the Buddhists are denying things, when they teach, then they teach selflessness and soullessness and kneelessness and thighlessness and nose, eye, ear, tongue, bodylessness. And then when they, relatively speaking, talk about it, then they'll talk about self. The Dhammapada, you know, who is in control of themselves, is in cool. That's referring to the self. And soul, jiva, is also redeemed as a relational thing and rejected as a fixed thing separate from everything else, separate from the body. Emptiness only means relativity. It means all relative things are empty of any non-relative essence, so therefore it's a complete commitment to relativity, is that understanding. When you completely commit to relativity, you then understand what the Lakota people say when they're broiling in a sweat lodge. They say, Oyatsuke miyasun, or something close to that. I always mix up the syllables, which means all beings are my relatives. When you realize all beings are your relatives, you realize all immigrants are like us. All enemies are like us. And then you feel love toward them. Right? Relativity. So it has a metaphysical, physical, scientific basis. The understanding is not mystical understanding. It's reasonable and scientific and experiential understanding. And that is the ground of love. That was Buddha's discovery. And when you have love and understanding, then you find relief. Because you have relief yourself. Poor Buddha. You know what, Buddha? You know, we really should be more kind to Buddha. You know why? Because what is a Buddha? How is Buddha defined? I mean, I'm not sure it's true. It could be a delusion. It could be like a hysterical thing they've been doing for thousands of years just to, I don't know, confuse people. Or wishful thinking, even. But Buddha is defined as a being who has identified with all other beings. Like you do when you fall in love with someone. And it's not only romantic, it's like an infant, you know. You have a newborn infant and the parents and the grandparents, especially the grandparents, I think parents are already tired. Grandparents identify with that child and they feel it's like the same as them, and so they love it, right? So a Buddha is a being who has that experience with all beings. So that means he loves all of us. He identifies with us. So this is the most beautiful thing. I think I only recently learned this. You know, Buddha nature? Our Buddha nature is our oneness with Buddha, actually. Buddha's doing the pan-Buddhistic heresy, right? You get burned at the stake in monotheistic religions by their religious institutions if you say you're one with God. They burn you at the stake because they want to keep that separate, so you have to get there through them so they can collect a lot of money from you and boss you around. But Buddha was everybody else, shares himself with everybody else. So when you put yourself down, when you identify yourself as a miserable creature, as like not having enough, as not enough, and this is nobody likes me enough, and I don't have enough, and when you do that, you're insulting Buddha, who thinks he's you. Do you realize that? Buddha thinks every single one of you, he thinks he's us. Poor guy, he thinks he's me. He doesn't know how miserable I am. And I think I know. I don't know how to identify with the Buddha in me that thinks it's all bliss. I haven't learned, but I will. I've gotten close enough that I know I will. And so will you. You don't have to be a Buddhist either. You do not. You just have to be aware of your own reality, really fully aware of every level of your own reality, beneath the subatomic particles, beneath the disappeared, in there in the quantum zone where there's no quantums, because everything is the speed of light. So everything, every mass is infinite, everybody's all interpenetrated in the realm of pure light, which is what we finally reduce ourselves to, right? Pure light that is not different from dark, because there are no shadows in that level of light, supposedly. Okay? But isn't that nice? You know, you would think Buddha nature is some sort of impersonal thing, you know. But actually, our Buddha nature is Buddha himself. And he himself, in that level, is the same as all the Buddhas. And yet each one as an individual, and poor Shakyamuni, he's responsible for us. People in Manhattan, all of them. And now the cockroaches. And the crocodiles under that guy that Pinchon thinks there's crocodiles in the sewers. He's responsible for them too, Buddha, right? So he's experiencing us in our everyday trauma, not knowing our everyday Buddhahood, right?
Oh, there you go. You encapsulated it right there.
So, okay, so that's enough. I've annoyed you all enough.
It's actually hard. We stopped. We only have 5 minutes.
And back to Dr. Mark.
Even
now, Dr. Mark will cure me
of my. Should I get out of the way?
Although I want to say one thing about Tibet. Actually, I had a great dream. What? Oh, is it? Oh, time is over.
Yeah.
Then I won't say anything. Another time. Tomorrow.
Can you say it in 2 minutes?
No. I did want to say one thing. I had this great dream. I didn't tell you about it.
Tell everyone.
You know, does everyone feel that Tibet is sort of a lost cause? China's finally crushed the life out of it, and the Dalai Lama's not coming to America, and he's saying, does everybody feel that? No? How many people are hopeful that we'll see a free Tibet under whatever sovereignty? Well, about 20%, huh? So most people feel it's kind of lost cause, right? 80%. That's realistic. Yeah. That's true. That's what it looks like. But I don't think so myself. I'm sure. I guarantee. By 2020, this will all be over. We'll have a great, probably female president, probably, if that's what it takes to get all you women to vote. Then we probably will, here, and China will change completely because Emperor Xi will change it. Mm. And I had this wonderful dream where he and I were on a picnic together with our mutual families, our grandchildren and stuff. He was so nice and friendly. And I was speaking fluent Chinese in the dream. Mm. I did learn Chinese once, but I've totally forgotten it. But in the dream, I was completely, it was all there, you know, mm-hmm. but it's not accessible to me now because 50 years ago I studied it. And I was yakking away, you know. And because I was preparing for when they would invade America and I'd be in a prison camp and want to have a cigarette, you know. So, and it's from the guards, you know. So he was saying that he liked Tara. You see Tara there? That's the white one, and that's the green one in that painting. And you see the little things, that little like dots on that? Those are subatomic Taras. And that reflects that sort of Buddha nature vision that every subatomic particle is a mini Tara, and even infinite numbers. And you never get to the nothingness, because there is no such thing. So there, anything you keep going inner and inner and inner, it's infinite. It goes infinite inside. You never reach nothing, because there is no nothing, right? So there's myriad Taras in there. And that means that you are all, atoms are full of Taras. Even the guys, your atoms are full of female Buddhas, every single one. That's why they don't fight each other, you know, in your arm, you know, the different cells in your arm, they work together and make a muscle, because they are female. If they're males, they'd all be fighting all the time. They could never lift anything, have no strength at all. Okay, that's enough.
Okay. Thank you.
This video was brought to you in part through the generous support of the Tibet House U.S. membership community and viewers like you. To learn more about the benefits of Tibet House membership, including special trips with Robert Thurman and geographic expeditions, please visit tibethouse.us.